In this video, we'll dive into your skeletal muscle cell, review the various structures that lie inside, and also the details of muscle contraction itself. For example, I'll discuss things like how these tiny proteins in our cells, myosin and actin, use calcium ions and ATP to ultimately shorten our muscles and generate contraction and force. Then, at the end of the video, I'll give you a couple of reasons why you should care about these details and why they're so cool, by explaining things like rigor mortis, an interesting phenomenon where muscles contract after death. This is the second video in a multi-part series that details the process of skeletal muscle contraction. You ready? Let's do it. Welcome to Physio Flip. As we saw in the last video, muscle contraction first begins with muscle excitement. This happens when a motor neuron releases acetylcholine, activating nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, allowing sodium to enter the muscle fiber and creating a positive graded potential. This increase in positivity then activates voltage-gated sodium channels, allowing even more sodium to enter and starting an action potential in the muscle itself. This muscle is now excited. That's great. But we don't have muscle contraction or force yet. The goal of this video is to explain how this excitation leads to muscle contraction in the process known as excitation contraction coupling. First, the action potential is going to travel and spread along the membrane of this muscle fiber, just like it travels down the axon of a neuron. Muscle fibers, though, have these unique structures called transverse tubules, or t-tubules, which are basically folds in the cell membrane which allow the action potentials to travel down and deep within the cell. And here's why these T-tubules are so important. In our muscle cells, many of the structures involved in contraction are buried deep within the muscle fiber itself, away from the outer edge of the cell. For example, deep within the muscle cell, we have many of these cylindrical structures known as myofibrils. Myofibrils contain sarcomeres, the structures in skeletal muscle cells that are made up of myosin and actin, the proteins that are directly responsible for contraction and force in the cell. We'll talk a bit more about these later. But for now, just keep in mind that the action potential's job is to activate these sarcomeres in these myofibrils to start contraction. So how can these action potentials traveling along the surface of the cell activate these hidden structures that seem to be buried deep within the cell? That's where T-tubules come in. T-tubules are folds in the membrane, allowing the action potential traveling along the cell membrane to reach deep into the cell, activating many more of these sarcomeres in the myofibrils, as we'll see in a bit. But for now, the action potential is traveling down the T-tubule deep into the muscle cell. Let's see what happens next. The action potential first runs into this spiderweb-like structure known as the sarcoplasmic reticulum, or SR for short. The SR, which surrounds myofibrils, is basically a calcium storage center. So when you think of the SR, think of calcium. And this is important because calcium is heavily involved in muscle contraction. The SR is storing a very high concentration of calcium, and the action potential's job is to force the SR to release that calcium in order to cause contraction. And if we zoom in on this section of the cell membrane, I'll show you how the action potential causes this release of calcium. Zooming in, you can see that the SR is packed full of calcium ions. The reason the SR has such a high concentration of calcium is because of this protein transporter, known as the calcium ATPase. Like its name suggests, this protein transporter uses energy in the form of ATP to pump calcium from low concentration on the outside of the SR to higher concentration on the inside of the SR. So this pump is responsible for keeping the calcium concentration very high inside the SR. But to get our muscles to contract, we need to let that calcium out of the SR. So do the opposite of what this pump is doing. Here's how that happens. As the action potential travels down the membrane of the T-tubule, it eventually runs into a protein known as DHP. DHP is a voltage-gated receptor on the muscle fiber's membrane that is physically connected to another protein known as RYR. RYR, a calcium channel located on the SR membrane, is basically the gate or the door that can allow calcium to leave the SR to activate muscle contraction. When the action potential reaches DHP, DHP changes shape. DHP won't open, but it does change shape enough so that it can pull on RYR, causing RYR to open. For that reason, I like to think of DHP like this little guy that can pull the plug and open RYR once it's activated by that action potential. Once RYR does open, this then allows calcium to leave the SR based on its electrochemical gradient and floods the inside of the muscle cell with a lot of calcium. This calcium will then be used to activate the sarcomeres and generate force, which we'll discuss in a bit. But for now, let's recap the steps we have so far. First, the motor neuron released acetylcholine, activating nicotinic receptors on the surface of the muscle fiber. This then allowed sodium to enter the cell, creating a positive excitatory signal or graded potential. This increase in positivity then activated voltage-gated sodium channels, starting an action potential. Using the T-tubules to travel deep into the muscle cell, the action potential changed DHP shape, leading to RYR opening and releasing calcium from the SR into the sarcoplasm, or the cytoplasm of the muscle cell. Okay, we're getting close, but we still don't have contraction or force. We're almost there, I promise. To see how force is generated due to this calcium being released, let's zoom in onto a small section of this sarcomere. In this sarcomere, we can see a variety of different proteins. Here we have the thick filament, composed mainly of the protein myosin, and the thin filament, composed mainly of the protein actin. Along the thin filament, we also have a couple other proteins, including tropomyosin and troponin. These four proteins together will help control if or how much force this muscle fiber's sarcomere can generate. To generate force in our muscles, myosin has to bind to actin. It has to grab it, pull on it, and shorten the sarcomere. However, myosin normally cannot bind to actin, because the protein tropomyosin is blocking access to actin. You can see the binding sites for myosin here on actin being blocked by tropomyosin. That's why I kind of like to think of myosin and actin like two teenagers who want to date. Myosin just wants to go out with actin, but there are these parents, tropomyosin and troponin, who are blocking that, preventing it from happening. But for this muscle to contract, we need myosin to bind to and pull on actin. So let's go through the steps that allow this myosin to bind to actin and eventually pull on it to generate force. First, myosin will bind ATP and break it down or hydrolyze it into ADP and an inorganic phosphate molecule. The energy released from this breakdown of ATP is then used to push the myosin back into position to an energetic state so it's ready to bind to actin. But tropomyosin is still in the way. The parents are still blocking myosin from dating actin. Well, that's where calcium comes in. Calcium can bind to troponin, activating both troponin and tropomyosin, which causes tropomyosin to change shape and expose the binding sites for myosin. That's why releasing calcium from the SR was so important. Without calcium, myosin could never bind to actin and would never generate force. Now with tropomyosin out of the way, myosin will now bind to actin, and by releasing the phosphate, generates the power stroke, which is just a fancy name for saying that myosin actually pulls on actin and generates force. At the end of the power stroke, the ADP molecule is also released, and the myosin will stay attached to actin in a state known as rigor. If we want to generate even more force, we need to just repeat this cycle. That will happen when a new ATP molecule binds to myosin, releasing the myosin from the actin. The ATP is then broken down just like we saw before, with the energy being used to push back the myosin and get it back into the ready and more energized state. If calcium is still present, myosin will bind to actin again and repeat the process to generate even more force. Let's quickly recap the steps of this process, often called the cross-bridge cycle. First, myosin breaks down or hydrolyzes an ATP molecule, using that energy to push the myosin back into a more energetic state and get it ready to bind to actin. Myosin will then bind to actin if calcium has been released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Myosin then releases the phosphate group, pulls on the thin filament, and slides it towards the center of the sarcomere, going through the power stroke and generating force. Next, myosin releases the ADP molecule, forming an even tighter bond with actin and entering a state known as rigor, in which the myosin has pulled on actin, is generating force, but is still stuck to the thin filament. To release myosin, either to help the muscle relax or to get myosin ready to start another cycle to generate even more force, myosin will bind ATP, releasing actin, and allowing us to start this process all over again. That's a lot of steps, right? But here's the result. Myosin will pull on actin and shorten the sarcomere to generate force. By the way, you might notice that neither actin or myosin filaments are actually getting shorter. All that happens is that actin slides over myosin, being pulled towards the center of the sarcomere, shortening the sarcomere to generate force. That's why this process is often called the sliding filament theory of muscle contraction, since the thick and thin filaments seem to slide over one another. So we've made this muscle contract, but we don't want our muscles to be contracting all the time. So how can we get it to relax? Well, we just turn everything off. Everything that we just did, we just stop doing it. The motor neuron has to stop firing action potentials to stop releasing acetylcholine. And without that acetylcholine, the muscle won't get excited and won't start action potentials. But without these action potentials traveling along the cell membrane and down the T-tubules, DHP cannot change shape, RYR will not open, and calcium will stay in its cage inside the SR. In this case, the only thing really happening is the calcium ATPase pump is using ATP to pump calcium back into the SR, preventing myosin from binding actin and therefore helping our muscles relax. All right.
I know what you're thinking. Who cares?
Seems like a lot of details, but I'm going to run through two reasons why you should care about this stuff a lot. Reason number one, it's just cool. All the details we learned in this video are actually happening inside your skeletal muscles every single time they contract. In fact, I can prove to you that this is how your cells really work.
Remember the sarcoplasmic reticulum, that calcium storage center?
Here's an actual image
taken by a high-resolution microscope showing the sarcoplasmic reticulum surrounding your myofibrils.
This is actually what it looks like inside your skeletal muscle cells. Right now. And remember that sarcomere? You can see that under the microscope too. The striations or horizontal lines here are the filaments in your sarcomeres. You can also clearly make out the T-tubules running along either side
and even parts of the sarcoplasmic reticulum as well.
So everything we learned in this video is actually happening every single time your eyes blink. Every time you get up, every time you use your diaphragm to breathe, it's because of DHP, RYR, calcium, and all these players we learned about in this video. Pretty awesome.
But you might not be convinced. Let me try this. Reason number two to care.
Rigor mortis. Rigor mortis is an interesting phenomenon in which skeletal muscle cells contract or experience rigor after death or post-mortem and can actually stay contracted for as long as a few days. But why would muscle cells contract after death? Let's explain why this happens using the material we learned. We learned that you definitely need to release calcium from the SR to cause muscle contraction. Post-mortem though,
motor neurons cannot fire action potentials,
which means acetylcholine can't be released, and action potentials cannot be started in the muscle. But we learned that these action potentials were necessary to cause calcium to be released. So how would muscles contract after death without action potentials happening? Weird.
Well, it turns out that after death,
the membrane of the SR begins to break down and spontaneously releases calcium without any action potential required, which allows for force to be generated. Additionally, in rigor mortis, not only do the muscles contract or experience rigor, but they also stay in that state for many hours or even days. Why is that? The reason is because after death, our body also stops being able to make ATP, and the cells eventually run out of this valuable energy source. But remember, we learned in this video that ATP was necessary to get myosin to unbind and release actin to cause the muscle to relax. So without ATP, the myosin will be unable to release actin, keeping the muscles contracted or in what we call the rigor state. So here's what happens in rigor mortis. Myosin can still bind to actin.
Since calcium is being released from the SR, since the SR membrane is breaking down over time,
myosin can then go through the steps we learned, pulling on actin and generating force and entering the normal state of rigor.
But after death, when the cells eventually run out of ATP,
this next step is no longer possible. Myosin can no longer unbind actin.
So when the cells run out of ATP, the myosin molecules will be stuck
in this rigor state, in the contracted state, leading to rigor mortis. And that's rigor mortis.
A unique example of skeletal muscle contraction without the need for neurons, acetylcholine, or even action potentials.